You are one of the most remarkable CEOs of the history of business. And you promoted a massive change at Unilever. And one of the things we want to hear from you is how you could make this change possible, transforming the organization in such a large scale as you did.
Well, let me first, before I do that, congratulate you what you're doing with Brightline. And you just explained to me the... There's one thing that I always remind people of, and that is that at the end of the day, execution is strategy. And sometimes we belittle it because we like to stay high up there with strategy. In fact, I've always believed you only should spend about 5 or 10% of your time on the strategy part, but then the hard work is really the execution. In our business, with this consumer goods business, no consumer buys me because I have a good strategy. They buy me because I'm in the store at the right price at the right time and slightly better than the others, and that's hard work day in, day out. So that connection needs to be made. And what we have seen in Unilever is the enormous power of a strong purpose. When a company has a strong purpose that people can rally themselves behind. For Unilever, when he founded the company, it was making cleanliness commonplace, give everybody access to a clean and hygiene environment. We've subsequently translated that into what we call the Unilever Sustainable Living Plan. It attracts people, it motivates people in the company, it generates this extra energy. And this aligned purpose that we have, we then obviously have to translate that into where the rubber hits the road, which is our executional plan. So for us, it meant a plan that, for example, as part of our strategy, decouples growth from environmental impact. We then started measuring all of our brands and what their impacts were across the value chain in terms of waste or carbon emission or water usage. So you have to measure these things, otherwise you don't get results. We treasure what we measure. And then once you have your purpose laid out, you have made your strategy around that, you put your measurements in place, then it becomes a matter of creating, first and foremost, actually the abilities. Often we ask people to do things, but we don't give them the abilities or capabilities to do this. So we invest an enormous amount of time in leadership development, finding your own purpose, but also putting capabilities in place to achieve these broad objectives that you set. And then it's all about enabling the organization to achieve it, celebrate success. You'll get into the virtuous circle you want to be in.
Yeah, and one point I want also to understand. Unilever is a massive organization. So how do you break the silos that naturally happen in such a large organization to drive people towards a common goal, a common objective?
So not easy, obviously, and often where you sit, you can get them on a common objective, but then it's so high and so abstract that it doesn't penetrate in the real day-to-day business. So that is really what you need to watch out for. What we find is if the purpose is strong enough, it is universal, it resonates with everybody, and it's underpinned with values that are universal for us: respect, integrity, pioneering, responsibility, and we embed that in all of our organizations, and that creates the glue or the trust that makes us work. And then you have a organizational philosophy where we empower people actually around that. We believe freedom in a framework. Many organizations become very controlled from the top, disempower on the bottom. And you don't get that creativity that drives growth. You actually stifle these companies and they decline. So we believe that you bring responsibility down to the level of where the knowledge is. Not easy. And obviously when functions are in an organization, you have to work very hard to bridge these silos in your compensation systems, in designing end-to-end systems that you want to solve, and not have these different functions, as you call them, in an organization live for their own rights. We have some challenges there as well. I don't want to make it sound that easy, but we, for example, have embedded decision rights very clearly in some people in the organization, and we say to others, you are all there to enable them to be successful. We don't say these are the goals for product supply, or these are the goals for marketing, or these are the goals for sales. No, we obviously have sub-goals to achieve, but we say no, we have the overarching company goals embedded in the purpose, and then we have within an organization the people that are the key decision makers that you actually ensure that they are successful. So you put yourself to the service of others.
Yeah, that's wonderful. And on the top of all your hard work at Unilever, you are a champion on sustainability. So you talk about that. And of course, today, everybody's talking how we can translate the sustainability approach, the sustainable development goals, how we can create a more inclusive world for the future, how we can transform these ideas into reality. What is your view?
I think it's starting to happen, and it's actually starting to happen at accelerated speed, because a few years ago still it might have been a discussion of a moral imperative, not leaving anybody behind. Why should someone live in poverty? How can you let someone die for lack of food security? And now it's actually, for the people that don't have that moral compass, which clearly seem to be too many still, unfortunately, you actually have the enormous economic forces that are driving it now. You're in a position where a human mankind has waited so long to address these issues that if we don't start to address them, the cost that we will be incurring is already higher than the cost of fixing it. That's why you see, for example, the market moving so fast to renewable energy or electric vehicles, or especially on the decarbonization side, but you see it coming in other areas as well. I think the best way to address it is actually not always with legislation, although at some points in time you need frameworks to get the free riders to be included as well. But most of it can be achieved actually more by transparency. I certainly believe that we operate in an environment where there is a lack of transparency, which actually undermines trust. And that's why you see this enormous trust deficit is there. For that reason, Unilever put out 50 targets on how we actually see the sustainable living plan being implemented. And we report on that every year in full transparency and have discussions around that. That has created an enormous amount of trust. But because it is transparent, it also drives behavior. We see clearly, for example, that companies that publish their financial risk related to climate in their value chain are actually making significantly faster progress than organizations that would not do this. So transparency is actually a wonderful thing. And the internet should give us increasing possibilities to do that.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Thank you very much for your inspiring words.
Thanks for your time.
Thank you very much.